Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. The Lord will be rejoicing. I know that. He'll descend from heaven with a shout.
Amen.
Amen. Our Lord, call us up with a shout.
Amen.
And don't you know that he, think about this, all excited. He'll be the one probably most excited.
Amen.
That that which he redeemed, he can now gather unto himself. Amen.
Amen.
What about that? That's a blessing. When the Father finally says, go get your bride.
Amen.
Amen. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. I know that you know, just in the carnal things, the earthly things, you know, when you're the one receiving what you have purchased or paid so much for, I don't know if there's anybody else more excited than you as an individual for what you're receiving. And it just makes me think that, well, sure, I know the Lord is going to be extremely happy when he can gather us unto himself.
Amen.
Amen. Bless his name. Somebody may have a testimony this evening or a song on your heart. Something you want to do for the Lord. Y'all have a song? Okay. Don't come out of here. Somebody may have a testimony while they're getting ready.
Thank God for the blessing.
Amen.
Amen. Thank the Lord. All right, let's pray for these girls while they sing.
Thank you.
touched on it just a little bit the last time we were in this chapter, and we'll finish up this chapter tonight, and what we're wanting to bring across tonight is the goal of the Christian liberty. The goal of the Christian liberty. The last time that we were in, we were talking about the cup of blessing, the communion cup, the bread of Christ, the body of Christ, the fellowship, us being partakers, and how that we're not to have, fellowship with those things apart from Christ. The things of this world. And he's using the communion fellowship to show us our spiritual position, our relationship with Christ and with one another, and our relationship as that it comes to the world. Which we're to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. The whole world, the Bible said, lieth in wickedness. The whole world lieth in wickedness. And those things that are not of faith are sin. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin.
Right.
So we need to be very careful about how far we take our Christian liberty.
Right.
All things we got down to verse 23 are lawful for me, but all things are not expedient.
Right.
All things are lawful for me, but all things edify not. That edification, listen, there are things that I may partake of that edify me, but a bigger part of my life should be concentrated in what I do, how that it will edify you. And the Christian life, love is not selfish. Love is not self-centered. And, one of the sins of the last days would be men shall be lovers of their own selves. It's what I want. It's what I want to do, what makes me feel good, and what I think. And, we don't concentrate a whole lot on how's it going to affect others.
Right.
My life. As long as it's self-serving and it pleases me, and men are lovers of their own selves. And that was the, if I'm not mistaken, first one on the list. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. Lovers of their own selves. Well, the Christian life is about loving others.
Amen.
It's about loving God first, and then loving the brethren, and then loving the world the way that we're supposed to love the world, in the sense of reaching the world.
Right.
Amen.
Not the things that are in the world. And so the apostle here has got to the place, and he's using this about eating and drinking. He started out with the communion, and now he's just talking about their daily life. Because of some of them, the places they lived in, they would go to the marketplaces to buy meat. They don't know whether it was offered to idols or not. The Apostle Paul is going to give them a great revelation as to how that they should live as God's people in that day of so many pagans. And he said in verse 24, "Let no man seek his own, but every man another wealth." In other words, their well-being. It's not saying that I shouldn't, take care of myself financially, that I should, look to get your finances. That's not what he's talking about, not at all. He's talking about their well-being when he mentions their wealth here. Not to seek your own, how you please your flesh, yourself, but you should seek how that you're going to help someone else's well-being.
Right.
And he said, "Whatsoever is sold in the shambles." Now these were the slaughterhouse markets. That's what he's talking about. "Whatsoever is sold in the shambles," sold in those slaughterhouse markets, that eat it. Asking no question for conscience sake. Now this is the Apostle Paul giving them advice. Now so what should I do? What should I do? Should I go to the market and say, do these support Black Lives Matter? No, I shouldn't ask the questions that are going to offend my conscience. Because if I run across the right answer and it offends my conscience, then because of conscience and because of faith, it'd be a sin for me to get it.
Hey.
Right.
And that is that's the drawing line. You say, well, so ignorance is bliss? I'm not saying ignorance is bliss. But the Apostle Paul is telling us, listen, we are living in this world where the world is all tied together. And you try to find any one thing, even a shirt, you buy, you'll never buy another shirt again. If you're trying to look for a perfect line system.
Right.
Because there is no righteousness in the world.
Amen.
If I'm looking for a good hamburger that the people who own the business ain't somehow tied in with something evil or sinful or wicked, right, I'll never eat another hamburger. Because this world, listen, there is no righteousness in this world.
Right.
But for conscience and faith's sake, whatsoever is sold in the shambles, that eat. Asking no questions for conscience sake. For the earth is the Lord's.
Amen.
And the fullness thereof. What about that? This is all God's anyway. Man may be buying and selling and think that they, but listen, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof.
Amen.
It all initially belongs to God.
Amen.
Every cow, every chicken, amen.
Amen.
That's right. Every lamb,
right,
the hills that the cows stand on, and the gold and the oil under the hills, amen. Amen. It all belongs to the Lord.
Amen.
The fullness thereof.
Yeah.
The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Everything that is produced from this earth, every gem, every diamond, every ounce of creek water,
water, or you listen, spring water, salt water, it all belongs to the Lord.
Amen.
The fullness of it. Every fruit, the fruit tree, the root of the fruit tree, the leaves of the fruit tree. Amen. That's produced. It all belongs to the Lord, the fullness thereof. And God is saying, so eat it. Don't ask questions. It comes from the Lord. All of it comes from the Lord. Amen. That's how you and I should look at it. When we go to the shambles or to the slaughterhouse market, we need to realize all of this belonged to the Lord anyway. So I can eat it. Oh my. If any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, and ye be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before you, eat, asking no question for conscience sake. What about that? If any of them that believe not, these are not Christians. These are unbelievers. If they bid you to a feast, we want to invite you to our picnic. Want you and your family to come. Well, then you go, he said. You go and you eat whatever's set before you. Don't ask no questions. What is this? The Jews used some of this for idol worship and kept some of it, and that's what we're eating. He said, don't ask them questions. Don't ask. Whatsoever is set before you, eat, asking no question for conscience sake. You see, because you and I, living by faith, has a whole lot to do whether we can do it with a clear conscience. And it is for conscience sake that you and I live the way we live. Not just in what we eat, but in every way that we live.
Right. Wow.
If something is bothersome to you, then don't do it for your conscience sake. Amen? Wow. If something is an offense in some way to your conscience, if it's a worry or a bother, then for conscience sake, you have faith in God and don't partake of whatever that it is. I'm not just talking about eating. I'm talking about what you put on your body.
Right.
I'm talking about where you live. Are you listening to me? Where you go? What you drive? What job you do? Are you listening?
Right.
If your conscience is bothered, then you've got to do something about that.
Right.
That's how we live, as part of how we live by faith. We can't, as God's people, go week after week, our conscience eating us alive.
Right.
We are built as God's people to do something about our conscience.
Right.
To do something about our mind. Why? Because that'll be a worry to our spirit. So he said, if any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, and you be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before you, eat, asking no question for conscience sake. But if any man say unto you, this is offered in sacrifice unto idols, eat not for his sake that showed it, and for conscience sake, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof.
Amen.
So, I'm at a picnic, and I'm fixing to eat that big juicy steak. I don't know, are you listening to me? All I know is it looks good. And a guy walks over to me and says, you know, why did you have to say that? Why did he have to go and ruin my steak? But if it was, this guy says, you know, this was offered to idols. Or, you know, this is what's going on here. That punch you're about to drink, that food you're about to eat, and he begins to expand. See, it's an offense to him. Now he's looking at you to see whether or not you're going to go ahead and eat. You say you're a Christian, but now you know. So what are you going to do? God said, don't eat it. Don't eat it for his sake that showed it, and for conscience sake. Because how could a God's child, having just been told that something was offered to idols or that something, there's wrong with something that I'm doing or fixing to do, how can I do it, especially in front of them?
Right.
Because they believe that it's wrong, then I should not do it in front of them, especially. But also because I've been told, now I've got a decision to make myself.
Right.
For conscience sake, don't touch it. Don't eat it. Just let it go. Let it go. Now this is in every part of life. I'm trying to help you out here. Every part of life. Listen to me. Let me be brutally honest with you. Used to years ago, I mean, people, they were, you know, a little more blunt about, you know, things that they saw, things that they'd say, and someone that didn't look just right. I mean, I've heard elder women tell younger women at different times. I'm talking about when I was a boy. You're not going out of the house looking like that. Oh, yes, I am. No, you're not. You look like a Jezebel. Now, if this person was saved, why in the world would they want to continue going on out of the house looking like a Jezebel?
Right.
Or a man. Listen to me. The same for a man. No. Why would a man want to look a certain way? Are you listening to me? He says he's saved by God's grace.
Come on.
It's not just about eating. It's about every part of your life.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
My goodness. Well, I'm telling you, right?
Amen. Right.
So, eat not for his sake that showed it, and for conscience sake. For the earth that is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. You need to remember that. It all belongs to God. And so Paul said that because there would be people saying, you know, it all belongs to God anyway. He's saying, yeah, it all does belong to God. But now you've got a brother that's offended. He would be overly offended if you partake. So now you've got a decision, but you've got to realize the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Hey, there's more things that you can do besides what's right there in front of you. In other words, you don't just absolutely, I've just absolutely got to have that. No, you don't.
Right.
There's plenty of other things. You don't have to have what's laid out in front of you.
Right.
Especially if it's an offense to your conscience. An offense to your brother or sister's conscience. He said, verse 29, conscience, I say, not thine own, but of the other. For why is my liberty judge of another man's conscience. Why is my liberty? When I'm at liberty, I feel that I am at liberty to do it. Then why is my liberty judged by his conscience? Oh, we're stepping in a little bit deeper because, listen, your liberty matters. And there are a lot of people say, well, I'm not convicted of this. This don't bother me. And are you listening to me?
Right.
Hey, you don't have the liberty to continue going on if it's offending them around you. Are you listening to me? You've got to stop and you've got to question your liberty. Because now it's no more liberty. It has everything to do with conscience now.
Right.
That liberty needs to be put back in conscience. It needs to be studied about and thought about. Is this edifying? Is this edifying? Is this lawful for me? Sure it is. But is this edifying? Is it edifying me? It may be edifying, but is it edifying everybody else? No, it's not edifying everybody else. Now it's not a true liberty, I don't believe. For if I, by grace, and you can't do anything greater than to do it by grace. If I, by grace, be a partaker, why am I evil spoken of? For that which I give thanks. I give thanks. I'm doing it by grace. Why are they talking evil of me? Well, let's put it in perspective. In everything, give thanks.
Amen.
There's a lot of guys out here say, you know, I don't think there's nothing wrong with drinking a couple of beers. It don't give me a buzz, and I don't get drunk. Well, I just have a hard time thinking that, you know, I could receive something like that by grace and have liberty just to chug it. Thank you, Lord. Really? People gonna do that? I ain't never seen nobody do that. I ain't never seen nobody do that. You're not gonna ever see anybody do that. You know why? Because down in their conscience they know that's a shame. Amen?
Amen.
Listen, don't take these things that you know. You know it's of the world. You know it's a sin. You know it's wrong. It's identical. Listen, it's used for the world in those ways. Why in the world would you, as God's child, want to do something that looks like the world?
Right.
Or that will lead you into temptation.
Amen.
Because it will. It will lead you into temptation. And that sure don't look like Christ.
Right.
I tell you, I don't care what people says. That don't look like Christ.
Amen.
Amen. If it does, then it ought to be all right for me to sit right here and do it.
Right.
Could you imagine your preacher sitting right here with a six pack? Are you listening to me? Absolutely not. Amen. To me, I can't think of anything that'd be more wicked or more ungodly for a man of God or anybody to do inside the house of God.
Amen.
Yet people are doing it at home. And say they have liberty to do it. Oh, I'm saved. It don't bother me. And it's more than just that. It's other things. Other things. Too many people want to be too much like the world.
Amen.
Oh, no, listen. You don't have the liberty to live in the world, flaunt your flesh,
right.
Amen, and offend God and His church on every hand. No,
amen.
You don't.
Amen.
No, I don't.
Right.
And use grace as your license. partaker, why am I evil spoken of for that which I give thanks? He's saying, I do it by grace. Look what he says, whether you therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Give none offense, neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God. Give none offense. Don't do anything that's going to offend somebody. Not to the Jew, not to the Gentile, not to the church of God. Even as I please all men in all things, not seeking mine own profit. This is the Christian life right here, friend. This is growing up. That's what this is. This is what you call growing up. Not seeking my own profit, but the profit of many. Why? That they may be saved.
Amen.
You know why I live the way that I live? And live that way in front of the church? Live that way in front of the Jews? Live this way in front of the Gentiles? Everything I do it that somebody might see Christ and be saved.
Amen.
That's the importance in how you and I live every day of our life. My liberty should be to show Christ to this dying world.
Amen.
That's where my liberty and your liberty should lead us.
Amen.
Our liberty to live as we should, or as we do, or as we please. All things are lawful. All things are expedient. All things are not expedient. All things edify not. The Christian life is living in a manner that the world sees Christ in you.
Amen.
That they don't see questions in you.
Amen. Yeah.
The world shouldn't see their self in you. They should see somebody that has something different.
Amen.
They should see somebody that has something that they know they lack.
Amen.
And that they know they need.
Amen.
They should see someone that's changed.
Amen.
They should see somebody. Listen, I have known people that said they're saved, and it seems like they spent their whole life arguing for sin. On its behalf, rather than against it.
Right.
Just something don't add up to me right there.
Right.
Something is not adding up. Somebody that says they're born again, saved by God's grace, shouldn't be trying to defend alcohol.
Amen.
Amen.
Somebody that's saved by God's grace, listen, shouldn't be trying to defend running around with no clothes on.
Amen.
Shouldn't be trying to defend shacking up.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Somebody that's saved shouldn't try to defend sin and the world.
Amen.
The things that are in the world. Amen.
Amen.
God's people should stand against sin.
Amen.
Not for it.
Amen.
I shouldn't be trying to make excuse for it.
Right.
I knew a man that said he's saved, spent his whole life, as far as I know, arguing why it was okay for him to have long hair.
Mm.
He never grew a lick in God. Do you know that?
Amen.
I don't even know if the man's alive today or whether he's even serving the Lord today. I doubt it very much, because you cannot argue for wrong and for sin and for the world and be right with God. There's no way.
Right.
Amen.
We're to fight the good fight of faith. We're to come out from among the world and be separate. We're not supposed to be like them, be part of them.
Right.
and I do what I do. Listen, you have a great liberty as a child of God. We're not bound. We have been set free.
Amen.
We have been set absolutely free to live a life of clear conscience. Do you know how many people would love to have a clear conscience today that don't have one? Yet God's people can live a life with a clear conscience.
Amen.
With a pure heart. Amen. Blessed are the pure in heart. Oh yes. You and I can have a clear conscience, a pure heart.
Amen.
Living for the Lord, loving the Lord, loving the brethren, loving everything about God, and loving this world to Christ.
Amen.
And listen, I'm not sitting in my house twiddling my thumbs, wringing my hands, wishing I could just do some of them things that they do, but I better not. I better not, because you know it might not come about the wrong way, but boy, I sure itching. No, listen, God took that itch away from me.
Amen.
God took the itch of the world away from me. He'll take the itch away from you. Amen?
Amen.
You won't be itching to get out here and do the things of the world, live like the world, drink like the world, eat like the world.
Amen.
No.
Amen.
God's given us much more to live for.
Amen.
Much more.
Amen.
The Apostle Paul is trying to bring them to that chief end of their Christian liberty, teaching them of how to live, what to do for conscience' sake, how that they could eat some of those things unless it was revealed to them. Once it's revealed, then they've got a decision. And see, you and I, when truth is revealed to us, truth, then we need to decide, am I going to walk in the light?
Right.
And also, this thing that I had liberty to do, I find out now it's an offense. What do I do with that? Just don't do it. Do what you do by grace. Grace, as many have said, is not a license to sin.
Amen.
It's a liberty from it.
Amen.
Liberty from it.
Wow.
Jesus paid it all.
Yeah.
Pay the debt that I could be free.
Amen.
That I could live a life, an abundant life.
Amen.
Listen, the Christian life, even right here in this world, is not a life of total exclusion. You can live an abundant life here.
All right.
Now. Just realizing there are more things for you and I to enjoy in this life about the things of God. Listen, I have never enjoyed serving the Lord like I enjoy today.
Amen.
To serve the Lord, to read His Word, to pray, to witness to people, to pray with God's people, to minister to you on a weekly basis. Listen, there's nothing that I find more joy in than doing that. There are times it is a burden that we all bear, but there's joy in living for Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Fullness of joy.
Amen.
And that's something we'll never find in the world.
Right.
Amen.
You're right.
Never, never. I want you to stand. Listen, I just tried to follow the Lord tonight. I didn't know that the message was going to go in necessarily the direction that it went in, but I tried my best to follow the Lord.
Amen.